Hello and welcome back to My Mom's Basement. I am here with Tony Khan. We are here at Barstool HQ ahead of Rampage. We've got a Saturday night Dynamite this
and
week.
And a Friday night Rampage.
Friday night Rampage is an awesome card. We've got CM Punk versus Matt Sydal. I just saw it's their first match on television in 10 years.
It's awesome, right?
It's crazy, yeah. How are you? Happy belated birthday.
Thank you, Rob.
Are you in New York to speak at a conference today?
I am. I'm speaking at a conference, but also I came to speak to you. I mean,
Nice.
When any chance I get to come in here, and it's great to be able to do the show with you, is a real pleasure. And I was excited to catch up ahead of like a huge week of AEW because Barstool has got one of the best fan bases for wrestling and sports, and you've got one of the best shows, and I was just excited to visit. So, and we have a lot to plug because like Friday Night Rampage, huge card. You mentioned Punk versus Sydal, that's a huge headline match. Plus, we have, of course, Ruby Soho versus the Bunny. Yeah. Big implications. TBS tournament coming up. This could, affect who's going to be involved. Somebody could get hurt before the tournament. And then to have, of course, Jorge Masvidal coming and be in the corner of Junior Dos Santos, the former UFC heavyweight champion, teaming with Scorpio Sky and Ethan Page, who are both very tough guys themselves. Scorpio Sky, former AEW tag champ and got a winning MMA record. And Ethan Page, a double black belt, which a lot of people didn't know about Ethan Page. And a very tough man himself going against Chris Jericho, Jake Hager, undefeated MMA fighter and pro wrestler world champion, and Sammy Guevara, the TNT champion. So it's a huge card.
TNT champion.
Friday night Rampage, and also...
And Bryan Danielson versus Bobby Fish, come on.
Saturday night Dynamite, Saturday. Bryan Danielson versus Bobby Fish, and something that I'm making clear just for the first time today in New York is there's going to be the buy-in for Rampage. I'm going to do a live YouTube, 9 o'clock on Friday night ahead of the 10 o'clock Rampage. We're going to put in a badass live card like we would for one of our great pay-per-views. There's going to be a buy-in for Friday night Rampage. And I'm telling you right now, ahead of the Bryan Danielson match, I'm really going to test Bobby Fish. I'm going to have Bobby Fish, and this is the first time I've said this anywhere in the world. I'll put it out here and break it on your show, Rob, that Bobby Fish is going to wrestle one of the best young wrestlers, Lee Moriarty, on the buy-in. And on the buy-in, Bryan Danielson himself. I'm going to book a match for Bryan Danielson, too, live ahead of his Bobby Fish match. It'll be fair Saturday night. They'll both go in on a day's rest and have another match on Saturday Night Dynamite. But Friday night's going to be a huge night of wrestling, and it's a huge weekend for the fans.
Wow.
It sucks to not be on Wednesday night, like this week, to be honest, because like we are on this great run recently. We had 6 straight weeks as the number one show on all cable and satellite on Wednesday night. The show is huge thanks to the great fans and the great support of Barstool and great outlets that give AEW coverage and have allowed AEW to come from literally nothing, nowhere 2 years ago to be now, in the eyes of many, many people, over 1 million fans, the number one wrestling company in America, thanks to you guys. And I just am like really fired up, even though we're not on Wednesday the next couple weeks. What it allows us to do is make these big weekend events. We do Friday Night Rampage every week on TNT, but then this week we get to do Friday Night Rampage and Saturday Night Dynamite.
Yeah.
And to be able to come during the week, at least with no Dynamite, I can come up in the middle of the week instead of like setting up for Dynamite and visit you and do your show.
Well, I appreciate that. We have a lot to talk about because you really made a lot of headlines this week on Twitter. It all started with a tweet where you said, I saw you doing a half an hour head-to-head with us. I can't wait to finally beat your main show head-to-head. It's been a long time coming. See you next Friday for AEW Rampage. Of course, talking about SmackDown is running over a half an hour. This made so many headlines all over
Twitter. It's the second time that they've decided to go head-to-head with us, and I want for the fans to be able to watch all the wrestling. I'll coin a phrase right now that I'll use from now on. WYW, watch your wrestling. I want people to watch your wrestling. Whatever you want to watch, watch it. And a lot of people have chosen to watch AEW because it's the best show. Watch your wrestling. And I want people to be able to watch everything. So it's the second time they've chosen to put their wrestling head-to-head with mine. And the last time they did it, it didn't happen overnight. But really, from the start, AEW consistently did better numbers than NXT.
Yeah.
And we eventually won that war, and AEW is now the Wednesday night show. Wednesday Night Dynamite has had a great run, and we'll be back on Wednesday in 2 weeks. But doing the show on Saturday this week, Friday, Saturdays, a big weekend for us. And now on Friday, they're doing a half hour head-to-head with Rampage, which is new. That's not something we've really allowed the shows to coexist. I put my show on, you know, consciously after SmackDown, knowing there's a huge audience of people that watch that show. And there's a lot of people that are going to watch Rampage, which has been a hit for TNT. And we've had nights where we've been number one. We've been in the top 10, top 20 consistently as a top show on cable. And it's like, for me, I want Rampage to be just as big as Dynamite in time, and Dynamite's consistently been number one. So my goal is for the show to be the top cable show. And if they're going to do a show on cable, that's great. We're competing for that. But they're literally going to do a half hour head to head with us. That's fine. Okay. And we'll see what happens. I'm not saying for sure we'll win, and maybe the odds are against us in some ways, but we're going to do the better show, I know. And if you don't believe me, watch whether go home show they did last night, because it sucked.
Talk that shit.
Am I? Did you watch it last night?
No, I didn't.
Have you heard it was bad?
Yeah, I did.
Okay, and like that's the prevailing opinion. I watched
Scream last night for the first time. Good movie.
I saw you said that, and you said like it hit the ground running. It's a great movie, and I'm glad you watched it. It's great. David Arquette's a really nice guy, big wrestling fan.
Yeah, I mean, big wrestler as well. He's WCW champion.
And he did Family Feud with our own Jungle Boy and Peter Avalon. And he's a great guy, David Arquette. But that's a great movie, and I'm glad you watched it, because like you said, it hit the ground running, and I saw you tweet that. What did you think about the rest of it?
I thought it was fantastic. Great mystery, great acting, great, you know.
Bunch of false finishes.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's a great original scary movie, the ones after it I didn't like as much, but the original Scary Movie is like a pretty good satire.
Yeah, like the Was Up, right?
Yeah, but that, not that. There's a bunch of like little moments. The Wayans brothers are pretty great, that like if you've seen the original Scream, there's like moments in the original Scary Movie, you're like, oh, that's actually very funny satire. Yeah. I like the Wayans brothers.
Speaking of things that we were tweeting about this week, you responded to one of my tweets, and this statement I feel like got a lot of traction on Reddit. It was all over like message boards, and you said Twitter is the child of the board and chat rooms that thrived during the 90s wrestling war, and that part of your business plan was recreating that competitive spirit, avoiding WCW's errors. As someone that was an internet wrestling fan in the late 90s, what was that like? Is it similar to today?
It is in many ways. What's happening right now is similar to what happened in like as the 90s went on. And right now I'd say we're into like the 96 phase. Okay. Where like big free agent moves have started to happen. Like WCW started to get a lot of traction in 94 when Hulk Hogan and then Randy Savage later that year came over, and WCW built, they already had a nice foundation of stars, and then Nitro happened in 95, and really, I think what's happening right now in many ways is similar, because in 96, there was a huge wave of free agency again, and even though not every business metric turned, you saw big growth for WCW, and it continued and continued, and I think had they not made some mistakes, but also they did a lot of great things along the way that nobody else has ever done, and still nobody's done in the history of the wrestling business, so you can't take those contributions lightly, but I think they would have had a much better chance to sustain and succeed and be around a long time had they not burned through a lot of the matches, which is something I'm very conscious of, and it's why I try to have a really deep roster, but do different matches that are exciting for the fans each week, but know that we're not going to burn through every combination of matches, because I think, first of all, we have maybe more young stars that we develop, and I think one of the mistakes WCW made in hindsight was they never got to see through the growth of their young stars. Yeah. Even if the company had stayed in business, Chris Jericho was gone and Eddie Guerrero was gone. And can you imagine, you know, for me, I think the young equivalent of those people, say like MJF, Darby Allin, Britt Baker, Jungle Boy, these people are really important, and they're part of AEW long term, both in my plans and literally under contract.
Look at Adam Page, the return of the Joker, that big pop. Like, that's an AEW talent right there.
And he was I think of him as a little more established. Everyone I named before, I think of as a homegrown star. Yeah. You know, he was obviously part of the Bullet Club and wrestled Bonner, on big shows in New Japan, sure. And then, you know, him coming in with Kenny Omega and the Young Bucks. But absolutely, he maybe made his name even more so in AEW. And what's happening with Kenny and Hangman right now is very exciting. Did you like the ladder match?
Oh, I loved it. Yeah, it was incredible.
I saw what you tweeted. I think you tweeted, like, everyone should put it on, right?
Yeah.
Thanks for tweeting. That was organic, and I didn't know you were going to say that. But I'm glad you felt that way, because it was a great match. And it really delivered, I think. It feels like up there, it's like
feels like they're having a ladder match up there.
They're on a rampage. It's what's happening on Friday night.
What the hell is going on up there? Construction or something? No, I mean, you have a combination of those six guys and then the Joker in a ladder match. I was like, yeah, I know for a fact that this is going to be amazing. There's no chance it's not going to be.
Thanks, man.
What was your wrestling username on the message boards? I know you remember.
I have a call, Coach Tony K.
Coach Tony K was back in the day.
And Tony Flair.
Okay, Tony. So you were like, Rick's son.
I guess. Yeah, no, I'm not maybe like a nephew.
And how have internet wrestling fans changed over the years?
Do you feel like in many ways it's very similar? I think that the 90s was the first time the wrestling fans really where there was a higher enough percentage of them where people wanted to do the job I do, be the booker. And that's really what you'd face. And it's kind of like in the NFL. Everybody thinks when you watch the game along the lines of what you would do if you were the coach, what plays you would call, when you would call timeout, when you would challenge. And it's one of the things that makes football compelling. And it's also something that makes wrestling compelling in the job that I do and that Vince does in WWE and in terms of being somebody that actually oversees like matchups and who's going to wrestle who. And booking shows and making plans. And so I think it's actually like there's now more so a higher percentage of the fans are that kind of fan where they think, okay, what should the next match be? What should the next show be? Why should this match go long? Why should this match go first or second? There's a lot of thinking. And now I think it's probably a higher percentage of the fans are hardcore fans than there were then. But there was this hardcore audience that really built, and I was there early to watch it through like the tape trading and the newsletters. So it's pretty cool, man. And there's a whole new generation of fans like yourself and all the great Barstool fans. And people, I know one thing about wrestling. There's so many cool things you learn from watching wrestling, whether it was as a child, I learned geography, vocabulary, like from watching wrestling. You can like learn things from watching wrestling and it's like really shaped me as a person. And I think like, by doing good stories and providing like good matches, I just think it's cool because like people wake up in the morning like caring about who the AEW champion is.
Yeah.
And like that matters to people. And that, so that it's been a long time, I think, since the title meant that much to somebody. And like, I know I want the title to stay important. And the shows, I just really believe as long as we keep doing like good shows that the fans like want to see, then we're going to keep our audience. And that's one of the things that I think, I really believe 20 plus years ago, WCW took their fans for granted a bunch of times, and I don't ever take you guys for granted. And that's one of the reasons I try to keep a lot up my sleeve, fresh matches, fresh stars, and constantly trying to make the show better.
Yeah. We're right down the road from Madison Square Garden right now. Does that building appeal to you as a promoter? Do you want to run Madison Square Garden in AEW?
It appealed to me at one point more so than it. But now I have Arthur Ashe and we have this.
You feel like
thing
that's the home of AEW in New York now?
I think it's one of the homes of, and certainly in New York City, I think it's the home of AEW. We have great things in the market and the area, but really New York's a bunch of markets. So in the New York City market and particularly what we have up there in Queens.
Long Island,
it's
right,
very special. And I would
love
to come. I'd love to come down here. We have UBS. What an amazing fan base we have in Long Island. And the numbers we've done for our pre-sale in UBS are pretty amazing. And I love going over to Newark and there's great fans there. But being in New York City was fantastic. Grand Slam in many ways is one of the biggest success stories we've ever had. So I definitely want to keep coming back to Arthur Ashe. And for MSG, I mean, it's been appealing to me, but you know, there's been a lot of wrestling there, whereas we're the only wrestling there's ever been. For Arthur Ashe, the Grand Slam is very special to AEW.
Yeah, where does that rank on like proud moments for you, Grand Slam?
Pretty high. I think All Out and Grand Slam are near the both near the top. I mean, the last few months have been great. It's a great time to be a wrestling fan and get into it, I think.
And when you're watching that opening match, that Kenny Omega, Bryan Danielson match, like you have to be pulled out of promoter mode a little bit, right? By how great that was.
Yeah, but it's hard to get
Are you still thinking about everything?
No, because I have to time.
Yeah, oh, wow.
So, and that was a very important match to be keep abreast of the time because it was like very, they did a 30-minute draw. And it's one of the best matches you'll ever see, 30 minutes of just great wrestling. And really, I mean, from the entrances to up to the 30 minutes of wrestling, I mean, the fans were so into it from the very bell, and it was one of the most compelling wrestling television events ever, and I think people will go back and watch it for many years. So I definitely soaked up the moment, but I also have to be very present because I always have to keep track of the time of the show.
When it comes to how Bryan Danielson's character has been booked, I'm such a big fan of his, and it feels like he's booked similarly to how he was prior to WWE. Kind of like the American Dragon style, I'm going to kick everyone's head in, I'm the best, I don't care who knows it. Was that more your decision or his?
It's us. It's us.
Together?
It's a collaborative thing. And it's like, it's working together. That's what I believe in, is like, whether it's with from the very beginning with Chris Jericho or the Young Bucks or Cody Rhodes, sitting with people, making plans together. And as I've gone on, you know, from 2020 and 2021, especially once I got out of the first few months, have been incredibly organized and hands-on dealing with each program, each person, you know, in major stars, major programs, and even down to the low programs. And I'm very intricate when it comes to booking scenarios, booking matches and stories. So, you know, Jericho from the very beginning is a great star who, you know, coming in, working with someone with that kind of experience, he had great ideas. I have a lot of ideas. So it's putting them together and trying to come up with good stories. And that's what it's been like with Bryan Danielson and also with CM Punk. Like, we sat together before he ever came on TV and we had built a really good relationship and a friendship and then sat down together and put together the ideas for the first dance, which was, you know, his idea to come as a surprise. And the first dance was my thought, the name of, you know, after I'd seen the last dance. And it's like, well, this is only the beginning and this is like would be something really cool. And he loved that. And it was a way to combine the surprise with the big box office event. And
I thought it was almost better that the surprise was also so talked about, because the first shot of the crowd chanting CM Punk and then the music hitting was like, it made it better. It was like when Jericho debuted on Raw and people in the crowd had the signs already that said Raw is Jericho. Like, you want that, you know? That was.
And we teased it a little more so even with Darby's
with
line, which I was
the only
Punk and I knew about what it was going to be. We had sat down and worked out this plan, and I had this line for Darby, and then I was at TV, and I gave it to him in the promo that he was Sting, so they knew. And then when they said it, the whole wrestling world exploded, yeah. And things have never been the same for AEW. It's a great time for us.
No, it's crazy. And I see debates all the time about, on like wrestling Twitter, about how much Bryan Danielson and CM Punk have like improved AEW and this, that. Can you share some insight into that?
Well, first of all, they just got it. It's literally, yeah. They both arrived last month. I mean, you know, Punk's been here on TV for almost 2 months, I guess, and Bryan's just been here like on TV for only a few weeks, really, on wrestling. So, you know, both of them have already impact us in terms of our pay-per-view. We've set our live attendance records for Grand Slam here.
The
and
YouTube
also,
numbers appear to be like skyrocketing too, right?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of, yeah, like I said, both have had a huge business lift. I'd say since Punk came in, before Bryan, and then now with Bryan, we've seen at least 6 business metrics go up. And we've had our all-time records for pay-per-view, those digital numbers, live event attendance, all-time high. And we were already, before the pandemic, the number one attendance wrestling company in the world. And this is all viral. AEW is a company that's been around for just a couple of years. We just had our 2-year anniversary show last week.
Yeah.
And it's pretty cool. And it's a movement, like, you know, very fitting in 2021, like same as Barstool, a viral movement that really rose up from the fans believing in something. And you guys have a great thing going here and have built
Thank you. Something amazing.
I think it's very similar in the wrestling world because, like, yeah. Same as you guys, everywhere you go, people want to talk about what you do, and you have these exciting young fans, and I think it's similar to AEW.
We've been talking a lot about wrestling Twitter and how in tune you are with it. What's one thing that you feel wrestling Twitter gets wrong on a constant basis that kind of frustrates you?
Oh, what a great question. That's a great question. I think like the biggest thing is like somebody says something on wrestling Twitter that's like a lie or makes a rumor up, and then everybody takes it as a fact because this one person just made it up or tweeted
it.
So yeah, and people run with it, and there's a lot of like things that have gotten traction. You're just like, if you know, you're like, that's not even true. But like one person said that, and you can almost track it back. So, and then there's just a lot of like, you know, stuff that's not true. But then of course the flip side of it is you get people that are like the, what then on the wrestling side of it, you have people that tell these obvious things. Like I heard the other day, Bruce was saying, like, you know, he'd never heard of Kenny Omega in 2019. And then literally they play the clip of 2018. And Bruce is talking
before.
A year before very intricately about Kenny. Yeah. So it's like, give me a break, man.
Yeah, that's tough. Is there any hardcore talks about the Owen Hart Cup yet? This is something I'm very fascinated
with. I am going to make announcements that were in due time. Okay. But I think, you know, we've got a couple big weekends. It's unusual doing Dynamite on a Saturday, but we always do Rampage Friday night. So it's a great chance, like I said, to make a go of it. And especially for the young fans, let's go. It's Friday night Rampage and Saturday night Dynamite. We can get after it and have a great weekend and party in Miami. For the fans that don't have weekend plans, it's going to be a kick-ass weekend. It'll be a lot of fun down there. We're going to rage again. It's great to be back there. And I think when we're back on Wednesday night, Dynamite, I plan to make more announcements about the Owen. And when we talked to Martha Hart originally, Jericho, who's another good friend of Barstool and a good friend of mine, and Martha Hartz, put Martha and myself together on Zoom during the pandemic, and we Zoomed a bunch of times and built a friendship. And I think Martha's got something really special that she wants to share with the wrestling world, which is the legacy of Owen Hart. And yeah, it's up to her, like, and she, you know, she has the choice of what wrestling company, if any, she ever wanted to work with to disseminate and really help build that indelible legacy of Owen Hart, this really great, important person in the history of pro wrestling. And I'm just glad that AEW is going to be, for a long time, the home of the legacy of Owen, and the Owen, this tournament is going to be really special, and we'll announce more about it, but I'm excited to tell you more.
I can't wait for it. I'm a sucker for tournaments in wrestling. King of the Ring, the G1, give me any of those.
You know what? This weekend, I'll have more information this weekend. We got Friday Night Rampage on TNT, Saturday Night Dynamite. I'm sure you were a fan of the AEW Eliminator tournament.
Yes.
And last year it culminated in Kenny versus Hangman, which is very fitting, because now as we go into full gear this year, we're back, and now Kenny's the world champion and he's facing Hangman, as we saw last year. And of course, Kenny won the Eliminator tournament last year and ended up winning the title from Jon Moxley. Well, now we have this huge Eliminator tournament coming up. I'm real excited about it. And we've got announcements coming up. I'll have the full bracket this weekend on TNT for the Eliminator tournament that will culminate in the finals again at Full Gear.
Wow, I can't wait for that. Finally, one more question for you. Is there any chance I can get an unsanctioned match against the guy who cut my mic when I was on Dynamite?
Yeah, who cut your mic? Was that?
Who cut, I don't know.
Well, I probably, I mean, you're not, I don't know if you're a sanctioned wrestler, man. You might have to get
That's
a wrestler's
license.
That's
why I said unsanctioned
I'll
match.
Tell you what, if you want to come down to, you know, there's a few wrestling schools. If you want to come train, like, I can't, I'll never
You know,
say
I did train for a summer.
Really?
Yeah.
Where?
In Rahway. Pat Buck trained me.
Pat Buck trained you for a summer? No kidding. Well,
when
maybe
I was in high school, I thought I wanted to be a wrestler.
Well,
this frame, it's a tough one.
You know what? We might be able to do something. Let me look at that.
All right. I'll show you. I took a super kick. I could take a hell of a super kick.
Well, I never say never, man. All right. I'm sorry about your mic getting cut, though, and I appreciate you having me here. And I'm glad my mic is working.
It might not be by the time this comes out. It might be all cut. No, but I appreciate it. And who knows? By the end of this interview, is Robbie Fox All Elite? The dirt sheets are going to be talking.
It could be. Maybe soon.
All right. Thanks, Tony.
Hey, thanks for having me, Rob.
Yeah, totally.